Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have James Cusumano and Riaz Meghji here. Jim, or Dr. Jim, he is the chairman and owner of Chateau Mcely, but he's also the author of I Can See Clearly and An Alchemist and so much more. We're going to talk some interesting things with Jim. And Riaz is a human connection expert. He is the author of Every Connection Counts. He and I have so much in common in the interests that we have in terms of connecting, speaking, and all the soft skills. So it's going to be a fascinating conversation, and we will talk to both Jim and Riaz after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Jim Cusumano, or James A. Cusumano. He is the author of 10 books, including a new novel, I Can See Clearly, Rise of a Supernatural Hero. He has done a lot of things, from being an entertainer, scientist, corporate, executive, entrepreneur, filmmaker, you name it, he's done it. So I am very excited to have him here. He's also the owner of Chateau Mcely, I think I'm saying it properly, which is an internationally acclaimed castle, hotel, spa, and forest retreat. And we're going to talk a little bit about everything. So it's so nice to have you here, Jim.
It's great to be here, Diane. And I love to do this because my main interest at this purpose, my life purpose now, I probably have had three of them throughout my life, but my life purpose now is to share what I've learned with others in the hopes that it might give them something to think about to help them on their way to fulfillment, joy, and happiness, and making this a better world.
Well, I think I think it's so important that people share what they've learned, and that's why I work with so many people who are mentors and different things. And you live in Prague now, right?
Yeah, I do. Uh-huh. I'm an American, but married to a Czech lady, actually born in Slovakia. Uh-huh. And we live in Prague. And Chateau Mcely is located just outside of Prague in a forest high on a hill with a great vista. And we can get to that as we talk about how did I travel this path, what did I learn, and why did I do it. That sort of thing.
Well, let's start. I want to get a backstory on you because I touched on just so quickly some of the things you've done, but where would you like to begin? Do you want to start with your backstory?
Well, yeah. What I'd like to do is, I didn't know this at the beginning. You know, as we get older, we learn some things. We like to think we get a little bit wiser. Uh-huh. But one of the things that I've learned is that life purpose is an incredibly important thing, and I'll tell you why. Let me just start by saying we all know that there are a number of global threats that we're dealing with that potentially could even be existential threats, things like climate change, nuclear proliferation, pandemics, which we're in the middle of. One that I'm not very happy with is, I call it toxic leadership, and we've seen that all around the world. Mm-hmm. Social inequality, mass migrations, and pollution, and the list goes on. And anyway, I think that everyone dreams, every single person that comes into this world early on, before they get confused, if they do get confused, they all dream of making a difference. And that's through a life purpose. Everybody wants to do something that makes the world a little bit better. They may tell you they want to make a lot of money. They may tell you they want to get highly promoted or become the president of this or that. And they may indeed want to do that. But behind all of that, they really, really want to do something. And that is to change the world a little bit for the better. Now, the reason I think life purpose is important, and it's rolled up in what I've just said, is that if you truly find your life purpose, and you may have one, two, or three of them throughout the world, and I can explain to you how that happens. If you find your life purpose, and hopefully you do, it winds up creating personal fulfillment. And also, because you have more and more people who are fulfilled, joyous, they're enjoying their life, it also leads to a number of what I would say are inspirational leaders. And these two things, as we increase the number of people who are happy with their lives and the number of inspirational leaders who can help change things, I think that is one of the fundamental secrets behind, at least that's what I've discovered over the years, sustainable humanity, and so that we don't have to deal in depth with all of these crazy issues that we are dealing with. And I kind of, when I look back after my life, and I'll talk about that in a moment, what I found is that there really is a path to fulfillment, joy, and happiness. Hmm. And this is kind of a condensed version how I look at it.
Okay.
I think every single person, you, myself, everyone we know who's a healthy human being, they are born into this world with something they're good at, some kind of asset. I call it their essence. And it, you know, it could be a hard skill, like they're good in the arts, music, dance, sports, science, math, writing, languages, or whatever. Or it could be something like a soft skill, which could be something like leadership, courage, compassion. Maybe they're resilient, they're a team player, or a great communicator. And everybody comes with one or more of these, either hard or soft, or both types of capabilities. And so what I think is the hardest part of this path to fulfillment is the first step. And that is to, first of all, discover what you're good at, what you really are good at. Don't think about how you're going to get a job to make a lot of money. Just think about what you're really, really good at. And then you need to, and this can take a week, a month, or years, you need to continue to look in the world and see, where is there a need that if with my skills, I could address that. And when you find the right one, and I have done that through my life, you find your life purpose. And what I have found for myself, and I spent 30 years in Silicon Valley with many of my colleagues there and many of the CEOs that I knew, what happens is it creates an incredible level of passion. And that passion manifests itself as energy, both physical energy and emotional energy. And in fact, you often find yourself skipping dinner or lunch, maybe not sleeping as much because you're so energetic. You know, mm-hmm. I'm sure you have felt that. Everybody's felt that they forget to eat because whatever they're doing, they really love.
Right.
And when you have that kind of energy, I think what psychologists have found is that it tightly links the left and right side of the brain so that you increase a dramatic connection between the analytical and the intuitive or creative side of your brain. And that allows you to solve problems like you've never thought you could solve before. You become amazed at the solutions that you can create. And that leads often to innovation,
right,
doing something new. And when you innovate, you get a reward. And the reward can be financial, it could be psychological, it could be emotional, it could be spiritual or some combination. And what I found is when you get those kinds of rewards after you follow that path, you can't help but being overwhelmed by gratefulness. And when you have gratefulness, this kind of gratefulness, it leads to long-term fulfillment, joy, and happiness. Now, I don't mean for a minute that you feel that way every second. Nobody
right.
can do that.
Right.
Well, I'm
curious where curiosity falls into that mix, but just because I'm an expert in that area. My dissertation was emotional intelligence, and I speak of soft skills and curiosity and perception, those kinds of things. So where do you think
yes.
curiosity? So to me, when I was looking at what inhibits curiosity, that was what I thought was so important, because if you could have that spark of curiosity, then that leads to the motivation, the engagement, the the drive, the innovation, right, and all the things you're talking about. So where does curiosity fall in your way of thinking?
I think we're curiosity is a valuable tool, and the only thing, one of the things that diminishes curiosity in my mind is fear.
Right.
If you're preoccupied with something that you're concerned about, and it could be from intense fear to a very mild level of fear, that cannot do anything but diminish your capability of expressing your curiosity in the way that could lead to really wonderful findings for you. Because fear, as we all know, uh-huh, it tends to constrict. It chokes, and the stronger it is, the more it chokes you. And so, managing ways to not be fearful or controlling your fear. Everybody gets fear at one
right.
time, but learning how to control it, I think, is a good path to helping you be a little bit more curious about what's going on around you and what you're doing, and that can lead to innovation and creativity, of course.
Well, you know, that ties so much into my research, which actually I thought fear was going to be so much more than just everything else, but it was one of the main factors, and it was fear, assumptions, so the thoughts in our heads telling us we're not going to like something, whatever it is, technology,
right,
over and underutilization of it, and our environment, people around us and what they've said and how they've guided us. So that, of course, I love that you tied right into my research. So that was that's great. So
I completely agree with what you just said,
mm-hmm,
because the idea of in assumptions and the environment, for example,
mm-hmm,
many of us as children, if you're interested in something that your parents, teachers, the media, your friends, a whole bunch of people think, wow, that would make a great job, you get a lot of encouragement.
Right.
But take the 10 or 12-year-old boy or girl who is really good in the arts. They're
mm-hmm
a great writer. They can draw, they can dance, they can sing, or, artistically
uh-huh
inclined.
Uh-huh.
And the first thing that some people will say to them is, oh, that's wonderful, Johnny or Jane, but how are you going to make a living at that?
Mm-hmm.
And before you know it, if they're young enough and they hear it enough, they get talked out of something that they're relatively very, very good at. And, just because you're good in the arts doesn't mean you have to be Pablo Picasso.
Right.
There's lots of things you can do.
That really goes along with Sir Ken Robinson's TED Talk, how we're educating people out of our competencies with our creativity and all that. And I think you brought up a really important point. And you help people with, your experiences, and you, before we got on the show, you mentioned you've had maybe seven different lives that you've lived and different things you've created. What was the most interesting thing that you've done that just has shaped you to where you are now, you think?
Well, let me tell you what they were.
Okay.
First of all, I discovered early on, we all have these giants in our life. One was my mother, who got me into entertainment, and the other was my father, who wanted me to be a physician, bought me a chemistry set. I didn't want to be a doctor, but he certainly not a doctor of medicine. And
mm-hmm
then it catalyzed my whole interest in chemistry and physics and mathematics. So when I look back, I didn't think about this when I was young, but if I look back, my hard skills were science, math, and entrepreneurship.
Hmm.
And the way I saw that is that, and then my soft skills were leadership, communications, and entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
So here's how they manifest themselves. I'm the oldest of 10 children.
Oh.
I've got, there are six boys, I mean, I'm sorry, six girls and four boys. I'm the oldest. And
wow.
Well, my mother was pregnant every 2 years, so she was home with babies.
I imagine.
And my father was a postman, so he didn't make much money. We grew up in Elizabeth and Newark, New Jersey, not far from Newark Airport.
Mm-hmm.
And we had to go to work because my father couldn't cut it with all of the kids. So
yeah,
the girls went to work as cleaning house or babysitting, and the boys sold newspapers. And growing up in the cold New Jersey winters, I wanted an inside job. So my mother, one of the giants in my life, said, Jim, you're pretty good at singing, You're pretty good on that piano, kidding around, playing by ear. How about if Dad gets you one of his friends to teach you pop music, because this was back in the 50s, and you start a little band. Maybe you can make money that way. And I did, and I made money with a little band playing for dances, the high school, and weddings, and you name it. And then one thing led to another. We lived across the river from Manhattan. I got into recording. And the next thing you knew, I was recording records, and we made an album. I was traveling with the pioneers of rock and roll music, Chuck Berry, Fats
wow.
Domino,
wow.
Buddy Holly and the
yeah.
Crickets. These were my colleagues when I was 15, 16, 17 years old. And it was a cool time to do it, because rock was very simple then, and even though there were a lot of crazy people in the business, but it, as a teenager, it's something that you could manage. So there I was doing rock and roll, but I had this thing in my heart for science. I just couldn't escape it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I eventually, even while I was playing with the group, I eventually got an undergraduate in chemistry and math, and then my doctorate in physical chemistry.
Wow.
And so now I said, okay, I got to get a daytime job. And that's when I went to corporate America as a scientist. I went to Exxon. They hired me. And I was a research scientist working with them, and eventually became their director of research for catalytic science and technology. Now, that was to play a very big role in my future, the becoming an expert in catalytic technology. And so after 7 years, my entrepreneurial bug was bothering me, and I just had to start a company, and a friend of mine said, what do you say we do that? And this was in 1974, at the height of one of the worst recessions in America, 21% interest rates. And I had a great job.
Mm-hmm.
But I was so passionate about the idea of taking my capability, my skill in catalytic science, and using it to help companies make processes which are more cost effective and more environmentally friendly. So this was doing something for the betterment of the world. I never thought about it back then that way, but that's what I wanted to do, and that was my passion. So my friend and I got in a car. We drove out to Silicon Valley, moved our families out there, and we started a company called Catalytica, which eventually, when the markets came back, morphed into two companies, two public companies. One, Catalytica Combustion Systems, which we invented and produced a way to burn natural gas with no pollution. And unfortunately, we were too early because they hadn't passed the laws yet. And so that one didn't fly too well. It did okay, but it didn't fly too well. We finally sold it to a Japanese company. But the next one was a super hit. And that was, I should say, a home run.
That was a billion dollar
we started a pharmaceutical company.
Mm-hmm.
And we did that with venture capital. And we ultimately raised almost $300 million to build this company. And we went from five people to 2,300 in less than 5 years. And we were on the NASDAQ stock exchange valued at over $1 billion. And, you know, we were just doing...
I'm curious, just because I worked for AstraZeneca
What we did, we were a contract research companies and contract manufacturing.
Oh,
so, for example... Pfizer mm-hmm. invested $20 million in us because they saw that we were capable of developing processes for their new drugs that were coming in the pipeline. That's one.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing, they weren't at that time, now that's changed, but at that time they weren't great at manufacturing, so they gave us a lot of their manufacturing, as did many of the other pharmaceutical companies. So we manufactured over 75 major drugs, prescription drugs, for companies around the world. We were the largest contract manufacturer of drugs in North America. We had three plants, one in California, one in Michigan, and one in North Carolina.
Did you do any for AstraZeneca? I'm just curious, just since I worked there. Were they one of the ones you've worked
with? We did some work for AstraZeneca,
uh-huh.
and I believe that was so long. I think it was before they became AstraZeneca.
Zeneca. Yeah, that's when I was working.
It was just that was just Zeneca then at the time.
ICI,
yeah.
Exactly.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's been out of ICI.
Yeah.
So that was kind of what we were doing, and then what happened was, and here's how you travel a path and you come to a crossroad, and every one of these things came to me at a crossroad. The next thing that happened is that our biggest competitor in Holland, DSM Pharmaceuticals, made our shareholders an offer they couldn't refuse. So we sold the company and made a lot of people very happy. We sold the company, and Jane was writing this. She wrote a screenplay for our daughter, and she wanted her to star in it. Ironically, the title of the movie was called What Matters Most. And I took the screenplay to Paramount Pictures, and I met with the chairperson, Sherry Lansing, who was the head of the Paramount at the time. Right. And she said, you know, Jim, this is a great screenplay, but Jane wants to direct the film, and she's never directed a film before, so we can't do that. So I said, boy, this is like a chicken and egg thing. So I had just sold my company, had some money. I said to Jane, let's start a movie company. And I started Chateau Mcely Films. Chateau Mcely was the name of the estate that we lived in, in Ojai, California, near Santa Barbara. Huh. And so we started this film company. We were going out to Texas, and unfortunately, here's the fork in the road. Mm-hmm. Jane finds out, it was 3.5 weeks before we left for Texas, that she had stage 4 breast cancer. Yeah, and she knew what was going to happen. I knew what was going to happen. It was really bad. And so I said, Jane, what do you want to do? And she says, I want to direct this movie, and I want to make it. And I arranged for her to get chemotherapy in Amarillo, Texas, while we were shooting the film 4 weeks in the panhandle of Texas. And we finished the film on May 1st, 2001, and Jane passed away on June 1st, but she got to see the movie.
What was the movie name
and
again?
So that, What Matters Most, it's now available on video on Amazon and some of the other places. Marshall Teague was one of the people. Uh-huh. And let me see if I can remember the guy who played the woman doctor. My brain is not...
Well, you've done. So many
I can't
things.
Remember.
I know there's so many things. Well, that's. I'm just. That must have been just such bitter.
Well, it was
it
really tough
for your wife. You know. Oh, I can't. Imagine.
Yeah, and so what I did is I brought it back to Sherry, and mm-hmm. she said, "Look, this is a great movie, but not for Paramount because mm-hmm. they're not A-type actors." So she said, "Why don't you take it to Lifetime Television and tell them I sent you?" And I did. Mm-hmm. They took the movie, it became one of their best films ever, and they renewed the contract twice. And then it went on to be released in 50 countries.
Wow. I'm sorry your wife didn't get to see that. That's amazing. Okay, so the movie gets out there, does this huge success, and then what do you do?
Okay,
do you go from there?
So then I'm sitting at home in my home in near Santa Barbara in Ojai, and a friend comes to visit with his wife, and her girlfriend from Prague is visiting, Inez, my current wife. And she gets out of the car, and I fall instantly in love with her. I never intended to get married again. I had 3 grandchildren. But things being what they were, I got on the next flight, came to Prague, and found out that she was CEO of a heritage restoration company that she had just left, restoring old buildings, and she had bought an old rundown castle, which had been 50 years old, 50 years without anybody in it. It was built in the 17th century. Huh. And she wanted to renovate it, you see, and she wanted to turn it into something special, which would be like an oasis of R&R, of body, mind, and spirit.
Right.
And it was more of a spiritual endeavor. And I said, great, let's do it. I don't know anything about castles, but I know about people. Uh-huh. And we did that. And we opened Chateau Mcely in 2006. And it's become an international award-winning castle hotel.
Wow.
And it has won all kinds of awards in Central Europe. And so, in fact, we were voted the world's leading green hotel because how we generate a lot of our own energy and electricity and that sort of thing. So basically now what I do is I have used Chateau Mcely as a base I bring change makers like Lance Secretan, Deepak Chopra, and others like that to teach courses at Chateau Mcely.
Right.
We have corporate programs in inspirational leadership and finding your life purpose. And so what I decided to do with my writing is to leave the idea of so much as nonfiction, because I've written a number of those books, like Balance Your Business Life Connection, where you have to connect, have to balance what you do in your personal life and your professional life, which is extremely difficult. And so I decided I'm going to write what I call wisdom fiction. And I thought that would capture a larger audience, which I could share my thoughts with. And basically, it's presenting an entertaining narrative, something that's like a thriller, which integrates lessons that I've learned, concepts that create a more fulfilling life, like life purpose, inspirational leadership, and elevated consciousness. And so that's what I've begun to do, and I'm getting some very good feedback. So basically, I can see clearly Rise of a Supernatural Hero is one of my first novels to do this, and it's basically, in this story, a talented teenager is seeking the meaning of life and his life purpose while fighting the grips of the CIA, who wants him to work for them as spy against the Russians, the North Koreans, and the Chinese, because he has these special superpowers. Hmm. And it's how he comes to grips with that and brings it to an ending. So I'm kind of excited about it. And
that's a great story. Is it going to be a movie? You think someday?
I don't know if I mentioned earlier that my son-in-law is a screenplay writer, mm-hmm. and director producer, and I'm going to get him to introduce me to the folks at Netflix and Amazon and put together a pitch to see if they'd be interested, because everybody who reads the book tells me the same thing. Can this be a movie or an episodic series?
You need to connect with Sheila Barry Driscoll was on my show. Do you know her?
No, I don't.
She's from the Driscoll family of strawberries. I'm sure you probably tried a million strawberries from Driscoll. But she does venture capitalist activity in the entertainment space, and she was on my show. So we'll probably link that. She was great, giving a lot of suggested input for the deck and all that for proposals, and she's a really interesting woman, and she does a lot. She used to run the Billionaire Foundation, I believe is what it was called, to help billionaires connect together, and I don't think that it's still a group anymore, but it was a really fascinating show, so you might want to check that out. But I would love that. Sounds like a great story.
Yeah, it is, and I'll look her up and see if there's some commonality of interest there, because I think it has great potential if the right team is put together behind the camera and in front of the camera. I think it could, and I have some experience making a movie, so I know a little bit about what some of the things are that are important that have to go on.
Well, you do so many interesting things, and how do you determine what you're going to do next? I mean, you've run all these companies, you've got chateaus, you've worked for, you know, Exxon's and all these things that you've done. Do you think you'll continue to write these books with, you know, wisdom fiction books or something else, movies? What's next for you?
Well, I would say this. I will, the main underpinning of that drives me is, how can I take what I've learned and share it with the world to help some people, if they want to listen, find fulfillment, joy, and happiness in their life and help make this a better world. And whatever the medium is to do that, I will continue to do it. I will do it by writing fiction, but if it leads to making movies and episodic series, which have an even broader potential, I will focus my energy there. This particular book I just wrote, I Can See Clearly, is part of a trilogy. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I just finished the first draft of the second book, book two, and it'll probably end in book three. But I think it makes a neat package for some of the things that I think would be entertaining. And I also think the world is changing. The younger people, this is kind of a 13 or 16 to 60 type of book, mm-hmm. In terms of years. And I think the world is changing, especially young people. They do not want to inherit the kind of world that they see coming towards them. They want to change it. They don't want to deal with the aftermath of climate change without doing anything. And they want to be serious about it. They want to be able to support healthcare in such a way that it deals with future pandemics in a much different way than the world has dealt with it, this one. And I think they are going to be our future. And those are some of the people that I'm trying to reach to give them hope and the tools to excite them to take their assets, their strengths,
right,
and help make this a better world. So everything I do in the future will be based on that, whether it's writing and or movies. And I can't see much beyond that. Everything that's come at me has usually come unexpectedly by some change of events where I had to make some kind of decision. So I'm open as long as it does make the world a better place.
Well, you do some amazing things, and I know I was looking at some of your websites. I liked, you know, Jim the Alchemist with a Y .com was is a great background on you. I also saw the Chateau Mcely webpage. Boy, those are beautiful rooms. It makes me want to go to Prague right now.
If you ever come, we have a special room for you, Diane. Oh, if you come,
I'd love
you know, all of the rooms they're named after the continents. Many of them are named after the continents or the months of the year. They don't have numbers, and they're very specially decorated. And my wife had a really good touch in doing that. So if you ever
beautiful.
Get here,
I'm looking at one with a harp in it. I mean, I'm like, this is a beautiful room.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Well, that's really, you know, it's so fun to get to learn more about what you worked on. I had seen everything in your bios and all the things that you've done, but you do even more. You know, as we were talking, I'm thinking, boy, you really have had an amazing background of everything that you've worked on, and I can't even, I would love to just spend the time talking quantum physics. I mean, I like to study astrophysics just because I love like Neil deGrasse Tyson's work and that type of thing. And oh, you know what, you might have also liked it. Right now we were watching, it's on PBS here in Arizona, last night we were watching Hemingway. They have a whole big background on him right now going on. Did you watch that by chance? You might find that interesting.
No, on Hemingway?
Yeah, they got a whole PBS that did a big, that I don't know. I never get on this station. I just saw it was PBS something. It was.
Did they talk about his travels in Africa?
It's just a big series, so I didn't get to that part yet. I was just watching part of his life with his kids last night, but it looked like my husband's been watching it. He loved it. He said it's really great. So I only caught a few minutes of it. But you might want to look for that because it looks pretty good.
Where is it on PBS?
Yeah, PBS is where it was, and I thought it looks like a really great thing, and maybe that'll be the next thing. Is I'll see your life story on PBS after Hemingway. It will be a fun thing to watch. But you know, I know a lot of people are listening to this, and they want to know where to find you, what to follow, how to learn more. Is there something you would like to share, or some way, or are those the main sites?
I think jimthealchemist.com is the best way, and it doesn't matter. I spell it with a Y, A-L-C-H-Y-M-I-S, because that's the way it was spelled a couple thousand years ago. But even if you spell it with an E, like it's like in the American dictionary, it'll still come to my site. And so jimthealchemist.com has a lot about all of the books I've written. It has a lot about me. And it even has a link to Chateau Mcely, our castle, hotel, and spa. So you can find out an awful lot of material there. And there are even links to Amazon where the book is sold and other booksellers. So that's probably a wealth of information that you can find right there.
Oh, well, thank you, Jim. This was so much fun. And I hope someday to get to meet you in person and see your beautiful chateau and all. And thank you so much for being on the show.
It was my pleasure, Diane, and good luck with all the work you're doing. I'm sure it's making a very positive difference.
Oh,
take care.
Thank you, and we'll be back right after this message.
Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Riaz Meghji, who is a human connection expert. He has 17 years of broadcast television experience, and during that time as a host on City TV's Breakfast Television, MTV Canada, TEDx Vancouver, CTV News, and Toronto International Film Festival, he interviewed thousands of experts about human connection and collaboration. And he has done a lot of work that has gone into his new book, Every Conversation Counts, which I saw had a little blurb on the front by a friend of the show, Michael Bungay Stanier. It's so nice to have you here, Riaz.
Thanks. Thanks, Diane. And yeah, Michael, he's a good man. I'm not surprised. He's a good friend of yours. He's a connector.
He's a great guy. Yeah, actually, I got to meet him in person at the Thinkers 50 event in London before everything went down, you know, where you couldn't fly anywhere. But it was really nice to see him in person. He was on the show, and he's really a great guy. But for him to write something so wonderful about your book, I'm sure that must meant a lot. And I want to talk about your book, but I want to get a backstory on you. I know, obviously, you have this broadcast background, but can you just kind of tell me how you got to that point?
Well, in 2002, I kind of took a shot. I took a shot at going after something.
Okay.
And once upon a time at Simon Fraser University, I was on the path finishing a business degree to become an investment broker.
Oh.
And after completing those studies, I was fortunate enough to have someone that saw what I would do in business presentations and on the stage, encouraged me to go after a career in the presentation space. And it was at that time that in the early 2000s, the media landscape, specifically in Canada, was a lot bigger with diverse voices and stations and opportunities. So I literally entered every contest, worked unpaid internships, and the first role I managed to land was an unpaid internship at MTV Canada.
Wow.
And learned everything I could. Obviously, when you're an investment broker trying to make the natural transition to broadcasting,
yeah,
there's a lot to learn.
Yeah.
So it was just really carving out the art of writing, presence on camera, and one thing led to another, and here we are 20 years later talking about it.
Well, we definitely have that in common, because I know I do a lot of videos with Dr. Gilda Carl, who was very much on the scene in the Sally Jesse Raphael show and all. I mean, she's been on everything from Howard Stern and on, you know, whatever. And so when she and I started doing our your media docs discussions about how to be on camera, I really think that there's just so much that goes into it that we hadn't even thought about, you know. And then now with Zoom having to be the way people communicate, there's just so much to talk about when it comes to talking about things. So I'm very interested in Every Conversation Counts, because you talk about these habits of human connection. Tell me a little about what you've got 5 habits, right?
Let's talk 5 habits, okay, in the book. Yeah.
And what are those 5 habits? Can we talk about them? We will go one at a time. And how do you want to talk about them?
Yeah, I think there are 5 big habits when it comes to listening, connection, curiosity. And the first one that I led with in this book, and maybe, you know, it really helps with the presence on camera, this habit of listening without distraction. And I've found and discovered over the years, anytime you talk about listening, someone will roll their eyes thinking somebody else is going to tell me to become a better listener. But the science and of how and why we connect and how our brains work was extremely fascinating.
Right.
Because we all as human beings have this insatiable appetite for information. But on a scientific level of how our brains work, our brains, we're almost too smart for our own good, Diane, because our brains can absorb 400 to 500 words per minute,
uh-huh,
yet the average person speaks at a rate of 125 words per minute.
Right.
That's why we truly have the capacity to multitask or get caught up in daydreaming or emotional distractions. But what if
when we have the pure intention to connect with someone through the camera, which we're doing virtually, or we're having a one-on-one conversation with someone, what if we could pinpoint those distractions getting in the way, have a heightened sense of awareness, and manage them so we're able to give them our gift of undivided attention? And that was one of the habits I doubled down on, of how we listen, the questions we can ask to really start to unlock somebody, and then documenting those details, those subtle details they give us. Like, for example, we started this conversation with an uncommon commonality of Michael Bungay Stanier.
Right.
And if I were to come to you a week, a month, a year down the line and say, hey, I just ran into Michael at a different event. I mentioned I was on your podcast, Diane. We had a great chat. Michael said this. That will bring it back to the point that you would say, oh, Riaz was listening to me, and that was the smallest detail I threw out.
Yeah.
But he remembered it.
Right.
And these little nuances will make a big difference right now, especially in this space of virtual communication.
Well, you bring up a lot of interesting things, because you brought up distraction. And what kind of things distract us?
Many. Like, if we take a look, baseline, technological distractions, mm-hmm. smartphones, screens, the access to information. Everything moves so quickly in this culture of convenience. So technological distraction is a big one. Emotional distraction, also a very tricky one, especially in this polarized climate we're living in, where if you or I, the two of us are having a conversation and we have differing opinions, it is so easy to close off emotionally or get emotionally overwhelmed if it's a heated discussion. And our emotions mute what somebody is trying to introduce. And I think there's a great opportunity for all of us, if we're going to be great listeners, to always, this is what, you know, advice a producer gave me at MTV when I first started back in the day, of always maintain a beginner's mindset.
Yeah.
Because in the beginner's mind, there's infinite possibilities, but in the experts, there's only a few. And emotional distractions definitely get in the way. And then the simple notion of multitasking or daydreaming. We just try to do more than we potentially need to do every single day. And when we cram all of that in, the question is, what is our presence and how are we providing attention to the task at hand or to the person in front of us?
It's so important to think about that, because just having been in sales my whole life, and you know, I wrote my dissertation on emotional intelligence and its impact on sales performance because I was so interested in the things that impact our performance. And I can remember just being a rep, not really listening to what the doctor's issues were at the beginning, just because I was so distracted by what I needed to say to sell them, you know. And I could see how people get that, you get in your head and you think, I got to do this, I better say that. And sometimes you just miss the next thing. And I guess that's what led to my interest in studying curiosity. And that's where, you know, I ended up in that space when meeting Michael, because of my work in curiosity. Because I really think curiosity is the key to so many things, because if you're curious, you're going to ask the questions that develop empathy, that develop a lot of this that I studied. But you talk about being assertively empathetic. I want to know what you meant by that.
Yeah, that's one of the key habits focused
mm-hmm.
on the book.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, curiosity, curiosity can be the kryptonite for distraction.
Mm-hmm.
And it keeps that learning mindset. And assertive empathy really operates under the guise of, how can we discover before we dismiss?
Yeah.
And when there's competing ideas or competing values, we could be so quick as a defense mechanism to shut it down and say, no, this is the way it is. We're thinking about, to your point, what we want to say, as opposed to, if we want to influence or persuade somebody, how do we understand what's motivating them or what's missing for them, and acknowledging them before we start challenging them with our own curiosity? So step one in that discovery is acknowledging that person.
Right.
Where they're at, what you know, what they're working through, especially when that news is tough. And there's been tough situations we've had to relay and communicate over the past year. And then once we've acknowledged them, recapping that we understand them, as opposed to assuming where they're at or what they're feeling. And then bringing in the logic. Once that relationship is established, relationship first, logic second, to focus on really what you can agree on, of what is the common goal here? What is the real challenge? What would it take for this to work for us, so we get to a place assertively. We're understanding them, we're feeling where they're at, but we're moving to a place where we're on the same side of a collaboration versus competing ends of a confrontation. And the curiosity and logic piece, I believe, if we use that once we prioritize the relationship, assertive empathy will really help us get to productive outcomes.
Yeah, I think it also helps a lot with, you know, our perception of the situation. It's just that sometimes you just don't know that your vantage point is so different from somebody else's. And if you can ask, I wrote with Dr. Maya Zelhich about perception, because we thought, you know, this is so important. It's kind of IQ, EQ, CQ for curiosity quotient, and CQ for cultural quotient combined when you look at perception. And if you can have that empathy and get out of your own space and trying to see things from other people's perspective, that's huge. And I know you had said to make people feel famous through the power of appreciation, and I think appreciation's huge. I want to know, how do you deal, like, I remember working with a guy who would send everybody pretty much the same email. You're the best, you're the greatest, you're the best, you're the best. And everybody would kind of go, oh, here's another letter saying I'm the best. How do you make people feel famous through the power of appreciation without being that guy?
Practice specificity. And a simple example, as you described that guy, that is so prevalent that no matter what somebody does, whether it's good or bad, some people are reluctant to even give constructive feedback. They'll just say, great job. Mm-hmm. And I think those two words, great job, are such a missed opportunity to truly recognize and appreciate what someone may have done and how valuable their contribution could be. And to practice specificity is looking at the simple idea of praise. So if you, Diane, have done this brilliant podcast on emotional intelligence as the behavioral expert that you are, to say, hey, that episode you did, Diane, really opened my eyes of how I can live more intentionally and do things differently. That is so much more valuable than me just emailing you and saying, Diane, great episode.
Yeah.
Because that gives you nothing.
Right.
And how do we make it how do we make it specific? How do we make it urgent that as soon as that episode comes out, you know, it's a really vulnerable position to be in if you're a presenter or a leader that's sharing an idea in a public space. We're never going to have 100% approval or buy-in to our idea, but that immediate feedback you can receive is so valuable with the timing. So being specific with our praise, being urgent, being public, sharing it on social media and tagging Diane Hamilton and saying, hey, the work, you know, she is doing in the leadership space is so valuable. And then above all, making it personal of, yeah, here's, you know, what you did was valuable, but here's why. So then the contributor or person can just realize, hey, they're making a difference in somebody's life. And I feel like we're missing that. I see this every single day of just generic appreciation as opposed to practicing specificity in the praise we could potentially give someone.
You know, I think that's why Doug Conant is so famous for what he did at Campbell Soup. And I taught so many business classes that they give the case study of that, because he wrote 30,000 plus handwritten notes to his employees and took their engagement just through the roof compared to where it was. And I think that specificity is something that he did. You know, he focused in on these individuals of what they did, and I don't know if he had any idea that he'd end up writing that many notes, and his eyes kind of roll in his head as he mentions how many, but it really made a difference. And I think that we often forget to acknowledge, you know, certain things in certain ways. But I also want to talk about how you write about the importance of crafting compelling stories, because I've had so many Hall of Fame speakers on this show. It doesn't matter who it is. If they're a great speaker, they all say you have to have good storytelling. You have to do, you take a story, you blow it up to a bigger size, make it this, make it that. That's a hard thing for a lot of people to do. They could tell a boring story, or they can tell a story that's maybe not funny or not anything that grabs, you know, compelling, like you say. How do you do that? What kind of advice do you give?
If someone is listening to this thinking they want to become a better storyteller, the starting point I always look at is coming up with a list of your top 10. Because I've had some leaders say to me, well, what if I don't have any great stories to tell? But if you're in a position where your career is developing, you've gone through some things, if you've moved up the ranks, and the simple baseline is, what is the conflict and what is the failure that exists in your narrative? And when you have that, a simple framework I give for any story is struggle, conflict, and resolution. Because I really double down on the human connection piece, and before anyone is going to cheer for our success, they need to feel and relate to what the struggle is. Like, connection happens in the struggle. And if you're going to tell that story, start as late as you can with what the struggle was. You know, so many people say to me, oh, okay, attention spans in virtual, it's tough, it's difficult. Even not even virtual, if somebody's on stage for 45 minutes to an hour, how do you keep their attention? Well, if you're watching your favorite show on Netflix, you're binge-watching it, and your attention span is just fine.
Yeah.
Because they've built a narrative that makes you care.
Right.
So whatever story I'm going to tell, I always think, okay, who's the audience? What's my purpose? What's my conflict or failure? And what's the teaching point I can give them? So I try to bring them into the struggle, articulate the high stakes with the conflict. Here, if I didn't make this decision, the business would have folded. Or this was a life or death decision. And then in the end, I just try to release that tension with the resolution of here's what happened, but more importantly, here's the teaching point. So the audience is going to be thinking the entire time, what's the point and what's in it for me, has been taken on an emotional journey of the struggle. They face the conflict. They ask themselves, well, what happened next? And then they got a lesson that they could apply to their own lives and hopefully have better days after it.
You know, that's so funny because I had Kate Adams on the show who wrote, she did a TEDx that was great. It was, or maybe it might have been TED, Life Lessons Learned from Soap Operas. And I was thinking as you were saying that, how we could learn, you know, we don't lose our attention. I could have watched Lost the whole way through, no problem, right? So, which it was basically a soap opera. What happens next? You know what I mean? And I think some of the stuff you keep people on the edge of their seat. It's kind of hard for some of us. I've had I was thinking of Susan Cain writing Quiet, you know, and how I've seen her speak, and she's not the type that runs across the stage doing wild things, but she was compelling her message. And I think sometimes we all think we have to be Zig Ziglar or whatever when we're communicating into a group or up on the stage. What do you tell people who are maybe more introverted when they're communicating on camera, even if it's virtually, and they're used to being around maybe extroverts who are all, you know, loud and, like, you know, different than they are? What advice would you give them?
That a compelling message starts with listening to what the audience needs. And
right.
Before I would take a stage,
mm-hmm.
Before, you know, take a stage or do anything in terms of a virtual keynote, I'm always using that intentional curiosity that we talked about earlier on in this conversation of understanding what's missing, you know, what do they really need right now? And that helps alleviate one anxiety of the uncertainty that will happen anytime you speak. I mean, when people ask me, well, how do I get past, you know, speaking anxiety, one, and then two, how do I make myself compelling on stage? If we are dialed into what that audience needs at any given point of time, especially this far into the pandemic, when we begin, they realize, oh, he's speaking to me. He knows what I'm going through.
Uh-huh.
And that makes a huge difference to unlock them because they want more then, because it's about them. I always say, look at you is greater than look at me. And as a speaker or presenter, I want to be that giver instead of the taker of the validation they can give me through applause and praise and just operate with the service mentality.
You know, and as you're talking about speakers, I think that's so important. And I think a lot of speakers are hurting right now because a lot of people aren't traveling, obviously, and they're not being hired. How do you see this affecting people who are in that space and they're trying to make a living doing this? Is there a way that they can be getting more business through virtual presence that that maybe they're missing?
Double down on YouTube. Double down on YouTube content. And here's what I've learned. When the pandemic started, I hired a YouTube coach because YouTube was always an afterthought. And I came from a broadcasting background, so I dismissed it. That was my fault, where I said, oh, that's a fun hobby platform to play on.
Right.
And I failed to understand the value of YouTube. Mm-hmm. So for 6 months, I did videos every single week, understanding that YouTube operates on an algorithm where you can be discovered. And if you use YouTube effectively and how you title your videos and tag your videos, and if your content is great, you can appear on the first search page of a topic. So say, for example, you talked about a virtual presence, how to elevate your virtual presence. If you title that correctly, companies are looking for that topic specifically right now. How do we elevate our virtual presence? Mm-hmm. And if your video shows up as a speaker, instead of a potential VP of HR or event organizer reading a blog, which may have some valuable takeaways, if they're seeing you on video, which virtually that's how their audience is going to see you, it develops a sense of trust,
right?
With, okay, I like this energy, I like this person, I love this message, to the point where you can use YouTube to generate your leads, you can generate trust, and the reach, the thing we've learned from virtual is accessibility around the world. You could be doing keynotes outside of your national market simply because if you're consistently showing up on YouTube and it's good, people will find you.
Yeah. How long are your videos you recommend for that kind of thing? You hear everything from 3 to 5 minutes, and then people are doing longer, some people are doing shorter. What advice would you give people for that?
Yeah, that's really good. And this is my business degree coming in, Diane, because YouTube has amazing analytics of seeing watch time. And a good YouTube video is considered to have a retention rate for your watch time of 40% and above.
Okay.
So I found a sweet spot between, I like to do them between 6 and 7 minutes, keep them bite-sized. And if you have somebody that's watching continuously for about 3.5-4 minutes, YouTube will recognize that as good content. So personally, I try to keep it tight and bright and address the problem and hit the key tips someone could take away in about 7 minutes. However, on the platform, if you make your videos longer than 10 minutes, and you have over 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 hours of watch time in any given year, you can monetize your channel in videos longer than 10 minutes. You can add advertisements at the beginning, middle, and end if they're longer than 10 minutes.
Yeah, it's a definitely a popular thing. It's interesting to see how we've gone to different platforms, different social media areas. I don't know if you're doing anything with Clubhouse with their being all audio. Is that something that you've dabbled in, or are you staying more on YouTube?
Yeah, I really love Clubhouse's format. Mm-hmm. And I think they were very smart with what they did in the pandemic, creating access to a fireside chat you'd have at a conference. But we can't travel right now. So it's less friction to get to the big names because they have big names playing on the platform.
Right.
That said, what happens with Clubhouse versus YouTube, for me, I prefer YouTube simply because as a presenter, it's a visual medium.
Right.
And YouTube is evergreen content. So Diane, we could create a video together tomorrow.
Right.
And it could be discovered next year or the year after. You know, there's such a sense of immediacy with likes, shares, retweets on social media where you need velocity right away. But YouTube could be discovered in another country months or a year later. Your content, if it's evergreen, it's still relevant,
right?
And it stands the test of time and can consistently generate you leads.
Yeah, and I think that's so important. And I know that's one thing I try to do with the radio show is keep evergreen content. That I incorporate this kind of show into my courses I teach, and so many of my entrepreneurship and leadership courses. This is so helpful, and I think that everybody who's listening to this is going to want to find out, you know, more from you. So this was really fun to hear about how every conversation counts and the 5 habits, of course, for human connection. So I would love for people to be able to find you, learn more about you, either, you know, buy your book, whatever. Is there some kind of site or something you'd like to share?
Oh, yeah. Thanks for the opportunity. Yeah. Just riazmeghji.com. Yeah, riazmeghji.com. Everything about the book, the message, and access to the YouTube videos just to help with human connection and even virtual communication is all there.
And if people are listening, that's RiazMeghji. So it'll be on the website and on DrDianeHamilton.com. And I hope that everybody takes some time to look up your book. Riaz, it's been so much fun having you on the show. Thank you so much.
Hey, thanks for the thoughtful question. Oh. I was kind of intimidated looking at your profile, and I just thought, hey, I hope I fit in on this one. So
no,
I appreciate
the comment.
Great.
Thank you for that. That's nice of you. But, you know, this was fun. We have so much in common. I'm sure we could talk all day. But we will be back right after this message.
Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate.
Well, we're out of time. I want to thank Jim and Riaz for being my guests today. We get so many great shows. I love having all these amazing guests. If you've missed any past episodes, you can catch them at drdianehamilton.com. And I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.